Hi, I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. In this video, I'm going to talk about touch sensation. And I'm also going to talk about what's called haptic perception. So haptic perception refers to the idea that we can explore the world through touching and through grasping, right? We can feel objects, right? We can, you know, squeeze them and apply pressure, and we can explore the world this way. So how exactly do we have this process of transduction happening? How do we go from the physical properties of these objects, and somehow by touching them, we're able to convert that into neural activity in the brain? Well, you probably partially know the answer already, and that's through our skin surface. So your skin, you've probably heard, is the largest organ in your body, right? And so it's not just a separation from the outer world to keep invaders out. It does do that, but it has many other types of receptors in it, so it can do a number of different things. So let's look at some of the things that the skin can do. So first we have things called mechanoreceptors, and these are receptors that can detect properties of the things that we touch. So we can detect things like pressure, right? So we have cells that are specialized to respond to different amounts of pressure, and then we can also sense vibration. So we have specialized neurons in our skin that respond to certain frequencies of vibration. Then we can also, when we touch things, we can feel texture, right? So rather than just feeling, you know, millions of isolated little points, we sort of recognize textures when we feel things. And along with that, we have this idea that we also sense patterns, right? So these are four properties that we can detect with our skin, and these use different types of receptors. And we're not going to go into detail on all these different types of receptors and how they're laid out in the skin. It's very complicated and actually not really all that well understood in how all of these systems work together. But we also have other receptors that detect other things. And, you know, you could probably think about, well, what can I sense with my skin? I probably have some type of receptor for it. So another thing that you can sense is temperature. And so that's going to use specialized receptors that are called thermoreceptors, right? So thermoreceptors are able to detect temperature. And then you also have receptors that respond to pain, right? So you have these nocireceptors. These are also called nociceptors, a shortened version, but it means the same thing. And so these nocireceptors detect pain, and these are very important. And in fact, I'm going to go into detail on pain in the next video. We'll talk about different types of pain receptors and why they're so important. Okay, we also, in some parts of our skin, we have things called chemoreceptors that can detect chemicals. Most notably, you have these on your tongue, right? So we'll talk about those in a separate video as well. Okay, so we have a number of different things we can detect on the skin surface. So then what happens is all of these messages go up the spinal cord and they get to the brain. And they get to a region called the somatosensory cortex. So this is a strip of cortex on the parietal lobe, right? So it runs down on either side of the parietal lobe. And there's two main things you should know about the somatosensory cortex. The first, you already know, is that it's contralateral. So remember this idea that the left side of the brain controls the right side of the body. Well, that applies to your skin sensation. So processing the information from the right side of your skin surface happens in your left hemisphere, and the opposite is true for the left side of your body happening in the right hemisphere. So remember that the somatosensory cortex is contralateral, and the other thing to know about it is that the greater amount of sensitivity that we have, right, that means we have more receptors there, that means we're going to need more cortex in the brain to process that information. So the idea here is that greater sensitivity I'm not sure what's happening with my pen here. Greater sensitivity means that we're going to need more cortex. And this is pretty logical. And you can actually demonstrate this. You can demonstrate these different regions of sensitivity in your skin with a test like this. So you get two little points. In this case, I've straightened out two paper clips. You can use two sharpened pencils or something. And you need a partner for this. And what you want to do is you're going to take turns poking each other, either with both of the points at once or with just one of the points. And you have to close your eyes and you try to guess, was that 2 points or just one? And you find if you do this on your fingertip, it's actually pretty easy to tell when it's two. You can put them really close together and it still feels different than the one. But if you try on other areas of your skin surface, you find suddenly you can't do this very well. So if you try this on your arm, suddenly they can be fairly far apart and it will still feel like just one point. And if you do it on your back or your shoulder, you'll find you're actually really bad at this. You can put them, half an inch apart, and to you it just feels like one poke. That's because you just don't have as many receptors there. It's not as sensitive. And then that means that in your brain, you just have less space in your somatic sensory cortex for processing information from your back in your skin surface compared to your hands, which take up a huge amount of space because they're so sensitive, right? They have lots of receptors in them, and so we need a lot of brain to process that. And this was first shown by Wilder Penfield, who is a neurosurgeon. I'll bring up a picture of Penfield here. And Penfield was doing brain surgery on patients, and he took advantage of this to study. He was able to do this while people were undergoing a surgical procedure. You can be conscious while you're having brain surgery because the brain doesn't have pain receptors or anything, or really any of these types of receptors I've been talking about. And so he found he can stimulate the brain of people who were awake, and they could tell him what they felt. And that's exactly what he did. And doing this, he was able to map out the somatosensory cortex, right? So he would stimulate a brain region, and people say, I feel that on my shoulder. And then he would stimulate another area, and they say, I feel that on my hand. It's on this part of my hand here. And so by doing this with the number of patients, Penfield was able to create essentially a map of the human body on the cortex, right? So this is called a homunculus, and homunculus is Latin for little man, right? So if we look at the somatosensory cortex, which is here, this is a sensory homunculus. We can see that it shows the different parts of our body mapped out onto the surface of the cortex here. And you can see that some areas take up a lot of space. Your lips take up a huge amount of space. They're very sensitive. Your hands are massive in terms of how much cortex they require. And then the rest of your body is like this little shriveled up part of it. And that's because you don't have that much sensitivity in most parts of your body. And so this is a version of the homunculus that Penfield published in the early 1950s, and it's still pretty much the same today. His research really has held up very well. The only exception I can think of is there's been some dispute about whether the genitals are actually underneath the feet as he has them here, and the evidence has been sort of mixed. People have tried to see if that's actually where they're located. Maybe it's hard to get people to come into the lab and study this. But otherwise, his work is still used. Okay, let's look on the other half of this picture, though, because this is a motor homunculus. So we can also map this out according to motor movements. So the motor cortex is another strip of cortex just in front of the somatosensory cortex. So the somatosensory cortex is in the parietal lobe, and then just in front of it, at the sort of end of the frontal lobe, is the motor homunculus. And you can see the same pattern applies, that the more complex movements require more brain space. So you can see, in this case, it's really striking. Your hands are massive. You're basically just mouth and hands in the motor homunculus, right? And that's because you make lots of very precise, delicate movements with your lips and your tongue in order to speak, right? If we didn't have that, we wouldn't be able to speak articulately or really at all. And then your hands, of course, you can move them in a seemingly infinite number of ways, whereas the rest of your joints, the rest of your body movements are pretty simple, right? Your elbow, right? How much can you really do with that? And the answer is not very much. You can bend it, you can straighten it, that's about it. So that's not going to require very much brain space. And you can see that here, the elbow, one little part of the brain there for controlling that movement, whereas the hands are huge. And then we can take these maps here, maps of the somatosensory cortex and the motor cortex, and we could create a model of a person. So if you looked like your brain surface, in other words, if those sizes corresponded to your actual size of your body, then the motor cortex would look something like this, right? You'd have these massive hands and a very large mouth, and then the rest of your body would be this sort of shriveled remnant of a body, really. So this is a map. This is from the London Natural History Museum. They have a little model here of a motor homunculus. And then On the other side, we have a sensory homunculus. So same idea, except this is for the somatosensory cortex, so the skin sensitivity in different areas. And you can see they're pretty much the same. Really, the only noticeable difference is the genitals on the sensory homunculus are much larger than on the motor homunculus. And that's because these are parts of the skin surface that are obviously very sensitive, but don't do very much in terms of movement. Okay, so that's touch sensation, the somatosensory cortex. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.